Right. So it seems, though, that the president, to his credit, actually did good on his promise of unity, because yesterday we saw even opposition figures joining that standing ovation. But what's ironic is the person who was beside him when he promised unity during the election campaigns was absent. What do you make out of that, of Vice President Sara Duterte's refusal, not just to attend the SONA, but to even watch the SONA from the comforts of her office or of her own?
Yeah, you'd actually, when I saw that statement, that was like a couple of hours before the SONA, and you know, it's really a declaration that the election season is upon us, and it's really now open season for negative campaigns, political mudslinging, and even those kind of like dig, right? Underhanded digs, right? So the vice president, she didn't have to issue that statement that she wouldn't be watching the SONA. I remember that the statement said that not even from any of, you know, any gadgets. So she wouldn't really watch the SONA even remotely, right? So it's a very strong statement. And I think this is really just proof that the Uniteam coalition is not just over. There's not just a collapse in the coalition, but they're now political enemies. I think it's pretty clear now. And you're right. If you will recall the address of the president, there's a marked absence of the unity rhetoric that you know, used to be so prominent in the president's speech, right? Even the Bagong Pilipinas has taken a backseat in terms of how it's used as a rhetorical device, right? But as expected, there were no direct digs on the vice president. She was not mentioned. The relationship, the breakdown in the relationship with the president wasn't really touched upon as well. Which is expected given, you know, what we know about the character of the president in terms of handling these political issues. But I think he also knows that the collapse of the Uniteam and this, you know, now that he cannot really deliver the promise of the unity, this is a really unpopular development, right? And I think they also know that this is driving a decrease in public support for both him, but also the vice president. So I think it's a good idea that he did not touch on it. But as a citizen, I'm also quite disappointed because it's a major development that the vice president left the cabinet and that the coalition that he sold the country is no longer present. So I would also have appreciated some comments on the part of the president on how he wants to move forward. But admittedly, of course, I think that's an unreasonable expectation given what we know about President Marcos. He rarely directly comments on these kinds of issues.
Right. He's quite averse to frictions, not only with his critics, but even with his allies. Aside from Vice President Sara Duterte, other noticeable absentees during the third SONA of President Marcos Jr. were Duterte loyalists and Davaoanya Senators Bongo and Ronald Bato de la Rosa. What kind of message does this send?
I think what I said, the Uniteam is not just over; they're now enemies, right? Political enemies, though. And as an observer, I actually expected that this term SONA will actually be used by the president as a campaign speech for the 2025 midterm elections. I was expecting that he would try to highlight give a prominence to some members of his supposed Senate slate, for example, right? But it didn't come. It was surprisingly tame, because he had the opportunity to make it a partisan event as well, right? Or to soft launch, for example, his Senate slate. He did not do that. But I think that some of the Duterte allied senators, including Senator Bongo, would have expected that would have happened. That is a possibility, and hence that might explain his absence, right? Because traditionally, that's also the purpose of the State of the Nation address prior to the midterm elections. But I think it's because the administration is in this awkward position that they are quite aware that they have popularity issues and that they have serious issues to address. I think they have decided to really face those issues head on first before actually going on a campaign mode. So that's probably for the better as well for the Marcos administration.
Like it. And speaking of strategies, let's now talk about the deep fake video of the president allegedly using cocaine. How effective was that in actually throwing shade and stealing the spotlight from the president?
Yeah, it wasn't successful. I think that's the first thing that we should say, right? It wasn't successful. It's definitely a very deliberate attempt to actually, as you've said, steal the spotlight from the president. It was released on the day of the State of the Nation address. So all eyes are on the president. And, you know, it if they succeeded, it would have been a really big issue for the administration. And it would have really overshadowed whatever the president declared, right? But, you know, this video, it appears that because I'm also taking a look at what experts, I'm not an expert on deepfake and these kinds of technologies, right? It appears that according to the notes of some experts that I have seen, that, you know, this one is fake. It's probably, it's unlikely to be the true video of the president, right? Yeah, and so, but I think the context here is that the 2025 election season is upon us. And therefore, it's really open season for all political players to do negative campaignings, political mudslinging, and to resort to, a really big problem now in Philippine politics, which is disinformation, right? The use of disinformative contents, fake news, deepfakes, and the likes, right? And what I want to say here is that, of course, the president is now the victim, right? Is now at the end of this particular disinformative campaign, right? But his campaign and the vice president's campaign in 2022, according to many research, really benefited a lot from disinformation campaigns as well, right? So now they're also experiencing and getting a taste of their own campaign strategy. So it's the boomerang hitting them back.
Right. I think it also deserves to be noted and mentioned that the administration, particularly the DILG and the DND, were quite quick to dismiss the video, to debunk the video. That kind of strategy, I think, played well for the president, instead of them just being passive, waiting for media to ask for interviews or to ask for statements. They actually mounted a press conference and even uploaded a video of the National Defense Secretary saying that there is a destabilization attempt against the administration. Now, all these developments, Cleve, makes one wonder how deep the fissures are between the president and his vice president. My final question to wrap up this interview, what should the Philippines expect in the next 2 months in the run-up to the filing of the certificates of candidacy for the 2025 elections?
Yeah, I think if there's any indication of how the battle lines, if you will be drawn in the coming months, I think we are getting a preview, a taste of that in the yesterday's address, right? It's looking like this administration will really distinguish themselves from their political rivals, the Dutertes, with three issues. How they're handling the anti-drug campaign, how they're handling the West Philippine Sea issue, and the banning of the POGO. So nothing on unity now. Even Bagong Pilipinas may play a secondary role in the rhetoric of the president now. I think this will be the lines that will be drawn by the Marcos administration and their allies, no? And because if you will look at the economic policies and what was discussed on the economic side, there's really not much controversy among our different political players on this particular economic policies, right? For example, rice importation, but also trying to give priority to our local agricultural production, right? Emphasis on building infrastructure, even the use of the 4Ps or the conditional cash transfers, right, as a poverty reduction mechanism, right? So there's really not much disagreement on these particular policy issues. But the three that I've mentioned, drug war, the West Philippine Sea, and the FOGO, it appears that the campaigns will centered around this. And this is also the issues that the Marcos can really distinguishes, can really distinguish themselves, no? From the Dutertes, because the Dutertes have a really completely different take on these issues, right? I also want to say that I think what's also probably not being highlighted in public conversation so far, that I think the banning of the FOGO is not just a an innocent policy declaration on the part of the president, right? I could also see it hitting so many birds actually with just one stone, right? I think that somehow, as I've said, what we're seeing is that there's a trajectory of decline in the public support for the president, and they know that that has to be arrested. They know that the banning of the FOGO is an issue that has popular demand, and I think that the president, given these considerations, was cornered into a cornered into policy declarations.
Please.
He may have feared, or sorry, go ahead.
Sorry, Cleve, just very quickly, we just have to insert and point out that the president actually underscored in his speech that his administration was quite successful in underscoring and in proving that there is no need to kill anyone just to curb the illegal drug raid.
Right. Well, it's very true that we now have less drug killings. But to completely say, for example, I remember is that the president called it a bloodless war on drugs, and that there is no place for extermination in the anti-drug campaign of Malacanang. I think that it's quite premature to declare that this is really a complete success and achievement, right? So for example, those who are still monitoring the number of drug-related killings found out that at least 700 people were killed, no, as part of the Marcos anti-drug campaign in his first 2 years in power. That's still a high number. We've also not heard from the president about, for example, the status of seeking justice and accountability, for example, for the many victims of the previous administration's drug war. I know that some people might say that, oh, that's not his drug war. That's true, but it is responsibility now. And if he's really committed to a proper anti-drug campaign, right, to a rehabilitative approach to anti-drug campaign, he must also seek justice for those. It's I also note that there were only few cases, right, that was filed against state agents as part of the Duterte drug war. And most of it were closed without even the filing of a criminal complaint, right? So I think there's a lot that the Marcos government can actually do to put action and to put really money into the words that they're claiming that this is, that they have a new approach to the war on drugs.
Right. And the big question remains, will the president actually have the guts to go after former President Rodrigo Duterte, the architect and perpetrator of the drug war here in the Philippines? We will have to wait and see what happens next. Again, thank you so much for joining us this morning, political scientist Cleve Arguelles.
Thank you, Kat, and good morning.